So we move on to this concept of orthogonality. In fact, it's not a new concept. Orthogonality of vectors is basically perpendicularity. We should be careful when thinking about vectors in coordinate spaces like line segments with arrows at the tip, because there are vectors that are not like that in abstract vector spaces where you have functions or other entities that are vectors. You may not be able to talk about perpendicularity, but this definition that the inner product of two vectors equal to zero will mean that they're orthogonal to each other, we will use. So there are different consequences to that. The first one is, of course, that the inner product or the dot product is zero. And the second one is that the projection of one vector onto the other is zero if they are orthogonal to each other. And orthogonal is basically the opposite of scale vectors or collinear vectors or even parallel vectors. Parallel means in the normal sense, the angle between two things is zero, and orthogonal means the angle between the two things is pi over two. All right, so let's also define a norm. This is something that we already did. A norm is defined as the square root of the sum of the squares of the components of the vector. So if it's got m components, then it's the sum like that, x1 squared plus x2 squared up to xm squared, the whole thing square rooted. So as you can see, this is the same as the dot product of the vector with itself, square rooted. That sum product is actually the dot product, and that is the square of the norm. Now, if you scale the norm, scale a vector by a number, and take the norm of the scaled vector, then the norm gets scaled by the absolute value of the scalar. So if you take negative of a vector and find its norm, it's the same as the norm of the original vector. Norm being the length, it doesn't have a sign, it's always positive, which is why you have to have this absolute value here for the scalar. So this normal definition of norm is called the Euclidean norm. Now let's look at the fact that the norm has to scale with scalar multiplication in absolute value. So the statement that we saw in the previous slide was not an accident. It's actually baked into the notion that the norm is actually the length or the size of the vector. In addition to the Euclidean norm that we defined there, we can define a general P norm, where P is any number greater than or equal to 1. It's a real number. P norm of x is the first component absolute value to the power p, second component to the power p, etc., up to all components raised to the power p summed up, and then taken the pth root, which is raised to the power 1 over p. So that is the definition of p norm. Again, you can see that if you scale this by s, p norm will have to scale by the absolute value of s. Now there are special cases. This again is something that we discussed earlier. We have Manhattan distance, which is a taxi cab distance, and the normal case, the 2 norm, p equal to 2, that is a Euclidean distance or Euclidean norm. So in this current example and in this course in general, we will be working with the 2 norm, Euclidean norm, and a large number of machine learning algorithms or pattern recognition or pattern detection algorithms like k-means clustering, for instance, uses the Euclidean distance by default, but they can use other distances too, and there have been some studies Euclidean distance has a problem with its sensitivity to outliers because it comes in as a square of the distance, and the square gets very big when you have an outlier. For that reason, some people prefer to use one norm, and that turns out to be more robust against outliers. So even though Euclidean distance is the normal natural distance that we think of, there are other distances also that are possible that you might be able to use in data science applications. Now, test for orthogonality, if it is two vectors, we are talking about vectors being orthogonal, it's just the dot product has to be equal to zero. Why this is true? This is actually not a definition per se, it is actually a consequence. We can actually prove it. Consequence means it's something that you can prove from more fundamental or foundational principles. So, first of all, by definition, we know that A dot B is a scalar. So A transpose B, being a sum product of a bunch of numbers, is a scalar. And by definition of a scalar, transpose of a scalar is itself. Scalar is a 1x1 matrix. It's a symmetric matrix. You take the transpose of it, it doesn't change. So we can say that A transpose B is equal to A transpose B, the whole thing transpose, which turns out to be B transpose A. So that's the first piece. So let's take two vectors, A and B. A is my red vector, and B is my blue vector. If I move the second vector to the tip of the first vector, I can look at the sum of the two vectors running from the beginning of the first vector to the tip of the second vector. That is my sum. And if A is orthogonal to B, A, B and the sum will form a right angle triangle, with the sum being the hypotenuse. So we have the famous Pythagoras theorem, which states that the size of A, which is the red vector, squared plus the size of B squared is equal to the size of the hypotenuse squared. We know that the size is actually the norm, so we write A norm squared, B norm squared is equal to the norm of A plus B squared. And we know the definition of the square of the norm as A transpose A for A, B transpose B for B, and A plus B transpose A plus B for A plus B, the norm square. And then by the property that the transpose of a sum is the sum of transposes, we can write the last statement here. Now, this is a product which you can expand, making sure that we don't shuffle the order because it's not commutative. So we get the four terms there by just distributing the multiplication. As you can see, the red ones, this guy and this guy, are the same, and the blue ones, they appear on the left hand side and the right hand side, so they get cancelled off. And what you get is that A transpose B plus B transpose A is equal to zero. But we proved by the product rule up here that A transpose B is the same as B transpose A, so each of them will have to be zero because they are the same. So that's how you kind of prove that if the vectors are perpendicular to each other, then their dot product is zero. This proof is not highly satisfactory in my book because we still use the angle and we still use the Pythagoras theorem, and so this is not very satisfactory from a linear algebra perspective because we didn't use the generalized vector and just the definition of dot product. At least in the case of normal vectors in normal coordinate spaces, this is true. So here is an example of it. I take a vector 5, 1, red vector, and my blue vector minus 1, 5 divided by 2, and they are perpendicular to each other. Then I can move B to the tip of A and find the sum there. That turns out to be 9, 7, the whole thing divided by 2. So if you look at the norm of A, that is just 5 squared plus 1 squared, square rooted, so that is square root of 26. Similarly, the norm of B will be half that much. And A squared plus B squared turns out to be 65 over 2. A squared plus B squared, the norm squares. And similarly, if you take A plus B, the whole thing squared, again, you will get 65 by 2. And if you take the dot product, it turns out to be 0. Moving on to projection of vectors. Suppose I have two vectors, A1 and A2. They have an angle of theta between them. What's the projection of A2 onto A1? And I will use the dot product using angles. Now, if you think of the dot product in terms of the cosine of the angle, then A1 transpose A2 is the norm of A1 times norm of A2, my red and blue vectors, times the cosine of the angle between them. So we can find the cosine of the angle between them in terms of the dot product and the norms. Then if I want to know the projection, what I would do is to construct this right angle triangle, because projection is like shining light onto my vector A2. The direction of the light is perpendicular to A1 because I'm projecting onto A1, and I'm looking at the shadow cast by A2. That's what I want to find. That is the mental picture of the projection. So the length of that projection is x. X, as you know from this right angle triangle, this guy is 90 degrees. So the blue one becomes the hypotenuse, and adjacent side is x. So hypotenuse times the cosine of the angle between them. That gives you adjacent side. So you get that. And from what I know as a cosine, I get A1 transpose A2 divided by the norm of A1 because A2 comes in the numerator there. Okay, that is my x. Now, for my purposes, it's not just the length of the projection that I want. I want a vector that is collinear with A1. In other words, I want to find the unit vector that is scaled by x. So I want to find the unit vector, which is A1 divided by the norm of A1. That will be a unit vector that will have the length of 1 along the direction of A1. Multiplying x, the length, that will give me my projection vector. So that vector I'll call A2 parallel because it's coming from A2 but parallel to A1. A2 parallel. That is A1 divided by norm of A1. A1 transpose A2 divided by the norm of A1 coming from here. And then in the denominator, I have norm of A1 square, which is A1 transpose A1. And the numerator, A1 times A1 transpose. So that is a nice little symmetry to this one. A1, A1 transpose divided by A1 transpose A1. So that we have to take a look at. So that red guy, the red fraction there, multiplying any vector A2, will give me the parallel part of that A2 onto A1. I'm going to just use A rather than A1 so that it's easier to write down. A transpose divided by A transpose A. That multiplying any vector A2 will give me my projection A2 parallel. So let's just worry about the red part. Now, Let's say that we're working in R3. So A is something like X, Y, Z. A transpose is going to be horizontal in a row. If I multiply A transpose A is the square of the norm of A. But if I multiply A transpose on the right with A, what's the shape of this beast? This is going to be in R what? It's a 3x3 matrix because this guy is a 3x1 and that guy is 1x3. So this and this will kind of cancel off and then we'll get a 3x3 matrix. Now this multiplication, think of the row picture of multiplication. This is a matrix here being multiplied on the right by some other matrix. By the row picture, I know that the rows of the product, let me call this product P, the rows of P are going to be linear combinations of the rows of the second matrix, but there's only one of them, the linear combinations of A transpose. And the second one also is a linear combination of A transpose. Third one also is another linear combination of A transpose. In fact, the first one, the linear combination is just X times that, and the second one is Y, the third one is Z times that. Now, if I have three rows that are all linear combinations of each other, what's the rank of P? P, remember, is my A transpose. What's the rank of A transpose if I have the three rows that are linear combinations of each other? There's only one independent row. Other two are linear combinations or linearly dependent on the first row. So the rank is only one. So this is a rank one matrix. Obviously, this is not going to be invertible because rank deficient is singular. So it's something to keep in mind. Now, we wrote down the rank one matrix corresponding to A1. And if I want to find the projection vector of A1 onto A2, all I have to do is to just change the digit 1 to 2 and 2 to 1. So I'll get this. So that is just symmetry of the formula. So you can actually compute A2 parallel or A1 parallel. So that is all about projection of vectors, projection of one vector onto another using the cosine of the angle between them. Now moving on to the other part, when you project a vector onto another vector, what you're getting is a parallel part. That's why we call it A2 parallel. But what about the perpendicular part? How do you get the perpendicular part? So let's take a look at that one. So what we did was to compute A2 parallel, and we had a nice little formula for that, which was essentially this. A1 transpose A1, that is a square of the norm. But I'm rewriting it. This is the way I would like it. So A1 divided by the norm of A1 is a unit vector along the direction of A1. That is what I will call Q1. And A1 transpose divided by norm of A1 is Q1 transpose. And now if you look at this part, this is Q1 dot A2. It's the dot product of Q1 and A2, which is the same as the dot product of A2 and Q1. So I can actually write it this way because that is just a number. I can take the transpose and you will get this one. So I can write Q1 and A2 transpose Q1. Now remember, this is just a number. The whole thing here is a number. It's just a number, so I can actually move it anywhere I want. So I am planning to move it to the beginning. So I write it this way. A2 transpose Q1, the whole thing being a number scalar, times Q1 is my parallel vector. This makes sense. What it is basically saying is that my parallel vector, A2 parallel, is in the direction of A1 because Q1 is in the direction of A1. Q1 is actually the specification of the direction of A1. And it's scaled by some number, which is actually the projection of A2 onto Q1. That is a dot product because Q1 has unit length. So Q1 is a unit vector specifying the direction of A1. So this is the parallel part that we got. So I just rewrote it in a form that will be convenient to me later on. But what I want is actually the perpendicular part, what is left of A2. How do I get that? What I will do is just subtract away the parallel part. Then I'll get whatever is left, which is the perpendicular part. So I'll move this guy over to the tip. Then I'll invert it and then add. So if I add the negative of A2 parallel, which means I subtract A2 parallel from A2, what is left is the perpendicular part. As you can see from this vector addition kind of diagram, this angle here is 90 degrees. So that's how you get the perpendicular part.